Can you see it at first glance? It's a picture of church doors in Kiev, Ukraine. Man, that would be awesome to have this for church doors. I mean, I love our church, I love our doors, but can you imagine if you had angels welcoming you when you walked in the door? Could you imagine golden rays of sunshine, the comfort, the peace? The thought that this is God's house inside, and here is where angels praise him to. Can you imagine this for a front door? And can you see anything wrong with it? Picture. Well, let me zoom out a little bit. Now, can you see what's wrong with it? I mean, I don't think they intended to be wrong, but man, it sure looks wrong, doesn't it? This couple here, the first time they went to church in Kiev, Ukraine, golden angels for church doors. Can you see how they look? Can you see how disinterested they are? Young millennials, what's the big deal? I mean, you can see it. I know it's hard, a little bit harder to show, but I got to show you the angels are pretty. You can see it on their faces. This is a young millennial couple that says, what's the deal? Here is glory for the background. Here is majesty inside. And their minds are elsewhere. Their minds are not focused on what's in front of them. They are thinking about something else. Have you ever done that in church? Ever come to church and thought about something else? Your body is present here, but your mind is elsewhere? Maybe you had a tough week. And your mind is processing your discouragement. You thought you'd be better by this point, but you're not. And you know God's present, but I can't get over that. Maybe you're here and your mind is on disappointment. You really thought you were going to get this promotion or this relationship or this thing, and you didn't. And it still hurts. Or maybe you're here and your mind is disillusioned. You had this goal in mind and you did not meet it. You're not sure if you're going to meet it. And while you're here and while you're listening and while you're praising, you're thinking, how am I going to get? Be honest with you, I'm a preacher. I preach every week. I see minds wandering all the time. And it used to bother me. It used to make me think, why is that? When you do it for a couple of years, you start to understand something. That when people come, even with the glory of God being taught, even with majestic visions and sounds and anything else, people had a tough week. People had a difficulty that week that sometimes can't let it go. Sometimes even the angels are on the front door. You can't let the hard week go that you just had. And if that's true for this couple, and if that is sometimes true for you, it's true of this man today. This man, Peter, who sees the most beautiful thing in all creation, his mind is wandering. It's the first thing that jumped out to me in this story. His mind is wandering. He sees something no other living human has ever seen. The glorious face of God. His mind isn't here. I tell you what, he shouldn't be wandering. He should be dead. Because God prophesied in his word that you can't see my face and live. He told this to Moses in Exodus chapter 33. He said, you cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live. That's why when you're reading this book and somebody thinks they see God, they freak out. They fall on the ground. They run away crying. They start begging for forgiveness. Even when angels show up, which aren't not as holy as God or beautiful as God, people still freak out. People knew from early on this idea, God is holy, I am not. And if God is here, I can't be in his presence. If God is there, the guilt and the shame and the fear that I have seeing God, I can't even meet him. That's why every other time in this book, if somebody thinks they see God, in the ground, out the door, or on the knees.
Jesus called Peter the devil.
because Peter didn't want to suffer. And when Jesus reserves such harsh words to such a close friend, it makes me sit back and listen. It makes me wonder if the sin of Peter is also the sin of Pete. Do I avoid suffering? Do I try to live a life that isn't harmful to me? Is it difficult? Oh yes, of course I do. Of course I do. I don't want to be ridiculed for my faith. I don't want to be attacked for what I believe. I don't want to be put down. So yes, we say. Yes, this is practical. This is pragmatic. So not probably. And yet Jesus rebukes him so harshly because that's the sin that lies latent in our hearts. The sin of a wanting to avoid suffering. That's a sin that I think starts early. It starts with the children, the teens, and the school. Somebody is saying something, we know that it's wrong, and you don't really want to speak up. You don't really want to correct them for what is wrong, because you'll lose that girlfriend and she'll make fun of you on this thing or whatever. You'll lose that friend and now you won't have anybody sit by at lunch. I don't want to say that because then they'll be looking at me. And what's interesting is that what happens as a teenager, as a child, never really changes. You get older and you look at the people close to you, your family members, your neighbors, and you don't really want to suffer. I don't want to have that conversation again with my child about the state because they're going to bark at me. I don't want to have that conversation with my relative because I don't know if they're going to let me see my grandkids. I don't want to have that conversation with my neighbor because then he's just going to be even more passive-aggressive than he already is. And then when you get older in life and you get even more mature, no, I've already had too many of those fights. No, we've already said that too many times. Let's just leave the Jesus thing out. I'll come to church on Sunday. I'll do this. But we're actually talking about it during the week. I'll get made fun of. I'll have pain. No, actually, I've had that stuff before. I'd like to follow you, but not actually have any consequences. I'd like to listen to you, but not actually have to listen to all of what you say. This is why Jesus called Peter the devil. This is why this sin has to be revealed so clearly in his heart and in my heart, probably in yours. Because we really don't want to be humiliated for our faith. We really don't want to suffer for our faith. And so we pass up opportunities to witness out of self-preservation. Imagine if Jesus did that. Imagine if Jesus decided to avoid humiliation for us. If he did that, even once you and I would already be damned in hell, not having this conversation. Now, Jesus embraces humiliation. He wants to be humiliated. He comes to this earth for the sole purpose of being humiliated so you and I could be exalted in him. He lets guys capture him. He lets guys strip him naked of his clothing and beat him with rods and put thorns into his head. He lets guys take nails to his hands and his feet and nail him to a cross. What humiliation for a man naked from a cross, bleeding and weeping, having his mother and his brother and everybody else who loves him watch the most humiliating thing. But that's how much he loved him. That's what he would do for us. Is that he would take the humiliation of the cross, scorning its shame, so you and I would be forgiven. He would take all of that suffering, all of that pain, all of that humiliation, so you and I could do something very simple. That when we come to God and admit, Lord, I've avoided this again. Lord, I've ignored your word again. Lord, I have sinned against you. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Something that simple. We have a God who says, I forgive you. We have a God who says, I am forgiven. Your faith in Jesus Christ, my Savior, your Savior, the one who suffered, the one who died, the one who rose again, he's provided forgiveness for all of your sins. He's provided grace and mercy for you. He has been humiliated in your place. And if you doubt that, if you question that, if you wonder if God could even do that for a sinner like you, look at today's story. God takes a wimpy, whiny man to a top of a mountain. He takes a man who is so focused on his past, he shows the glory of God. And God doesn't even smite Peter. God doesn't even damn Peter. God doesn't even punish Peter. No, God shows his glory to weak people who can't go to the past. God shows his glory today to weak people who can't get over our past either. Because that's the glory we soon shall see. That's the glory we soon shall see face to face in heaven. In heaven, we will see God's face, and we will not run, we will not die, we will not cry. We'll just talk to him. We'll just sing with him. We will see the most majestic thing in the world, and it will seem normal to us, because everything is perfect. Everything is holy. God has wiped away my sins and brought me to glory everlasting. And that's what he shows this man this morning. That's what he shows these men and women this morning. Hold on, guys. You're going to see my face for eternity. Hold on, guys. In all of your difficulties, in all of your past, you will be with me forever. I won't have to veil myself. I won't have to restrict myself. I will just show my majesty. You won't be able to remember anything. The transfiguration is for people who have had bad weeks. The story of the transfiguration is for people who have rough pasts. The story of the transfiguration is for you who walked in here and maybe your mind was wandering a little bit because you've had something difficult you're going through or just got through. The story of the transfiguration is that there is greater, more majestic glory than even beautiful church doors in Kiev, Ukraine. Because try as the artist may, and as golden as that entire cathedral is, this isn't even close. This is nothing like the face of God, that we will have something, that we will see something. Jesus dazzles for us today to get you through today and tomorrow. Because he knows you have hard work. He knows that you're frustrated. He knows that you're discouraged and disappointed and disillusioned. He knows the feeling of running low. And so he gives you the most angelic boost. Here. Here is what you will see in all eternity. Here is the life that I have prepared for you since the beginning of the world. Here is what you have forever. Yeah, you got to go to work tomorrow. Yeah, you got to go home with those people. Yeah, you've got a difficult friend life, and you're not quite sure about what's going to happen with all these people towards you. Yeah, that's going to still happen. But one day, all you will see is God's face, and you will say like Peter, let's make a shelter. I don't want to go anywhere. Let's stay here forever. And you never have to go down the mountain. You never have to go back to work. You never have to see anything wrong ever again. This is a dazzling story of what you get for all eternity. So hold on to it. Hold on to it no matter how hard life is, no matter how depressed you feel, no matter how scared you might be. Hold on to this because it dazzles you to get you through today and tomorrow.